ACHP has a new vice chairman, Rick Gonzalez, an architect from Florida. He was appointed by President Donald Trump and sworn in as a new member in June. He was designated as vice chairman in July. I had a chance to speak with Rick Gonzalez just recently, and I asked him about his background and how his interest in historic preservation developed. Now here's my interview with Rick Gonzalez. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you. Thank you, Lynne.
You know what's really great? Whenever we get a new ACHP member, everybody comes from such different and varied backgrounds and has a variety of expertise. And you are definitely someone who has a variety of expertise and a very interesting background. Can you tell us a little bit about your background?
Sure. Let's see. I was born in Cuba. And I left in 1961 when I was a little baby, and raised in South Florida and in Costa Rica. My father, Ricardo, was an architect, and he traveled Atlanta, Florida, and Costa Rica. And so grew up in diverse places. Then I had an opportunity to do college in several places. I started in Costa Rica, spent a year in Guatemala, which is a beautiful country. And then I finished my studies in Miami-Dade College and then at Catholic University in Washington, D.C. After graduation, I missed South Florida, so I came back to South Florida in the mid-80s, but I relocated to Palm Beach from Miami. I found Palm Beach County to be a wonderful place, opportunities for a young architect, and encouraged my dad to help me start our own company in 1988. 32 years ago. So it's been a pretty fun ride.
Where in that journey did you first discover that you were interested in historic preservation?
Good question. As a young student growing up in Miami, I grew up in the Rhodes section, which is a historic Shenandoah neighborhood. So my neighborhood was one of old Florida houses, the mission style homes, small mixed use apartment type buildings with shops below, believe it or not, very walkable part of Miami. That interest then grew when we moved to Costa Rica. San Jose is the capital. We lived in the suburbs, but I used to take three buses to go to school. And part of my experience required me at the age of 13, 14, 15 to walk through the city and, as I switched from one bus to the other, so enjoying the historic buildings in Costa Rica. And then also my dad, you know, my dad being an architect trained in Cuba at Villanova in Cuba and Havana, and his love for Havana and the architecture of Cuba was something that through the years also I found very interesting and made me very curious. I'd sneak into his office to see, you know, his drawings or mess with his markers or, you know, just pretend that I was an architect as a young person. But I think the combined experience of my growing up in Miami near downtown, in San Jose, Costa Rica, and also my father and his stories about Havana and Cuba.
I think that a lot of people might not think of Florida as the center of history. And that they might not be familiar with all the different historic aspects of Southern Florida. So what would people be surprised about that you've learned working there?
Oh boy, well, I work all over the state of Florida. And I think the number one shocker might be that St. Augustine was doing urban renewal when folks landed on Plymouth Rock. So I hate to tell my friends from New England, they really weren't the first ones, you know? Granted, it was La Florida, right? So it was part of the Spanish kingdom, but it was the North American territory in a way, right? So that's a big one. That's one that there's been some new films, documentaries produced recently about that up in St. Augustine. I sit on a couple of boards up there, and it's very interesting to see that we have this amazing history that goes back, you know, almost 500 years. Closer to home in Palm Beach in South Florida, you know, our history is not that old, to be honest with you. It's about 100 to 150 years, the oldest buildings, but it's fascinating. And it's a great eclectic variety of places. So you get to see, you know, history and downtowns and small towns and in settings that you'd find very uniquely down here, from the big mansions like Mar-a-Lago on the ocean, to small places like Overtown in right next to downtown Miami, a historic African-American community that's been thriving very much recently too.
You've gotten to, as an architect, work on many historic buildings. Can you tell me about some of the most interesting and exciting ones that you've worked on?
Oh my gosh, well, I love historic preservation work. In fact, when I work on a historic building, I like to call them a jewel, you know, and I feel like I have this necklace, you know, with all these jewels, which are all the buildings I've had a chance to work on. I have four children, so I'm not going to say they're my children, you know, but in a way too, you know, and I've had the pleasure of working some fantastic buildings over the years. One that might be a surprise for everyone is that I've worked with the president. I worked with him for 25 years. I started in 1995 at Mar-a-Lago, which is the Marjorie Merriweather Post Estate in Palm Beach, which we turned into a club. And over the years, over 25 years, we've done ballroom, pool facilities, tennis facilities, really converting the historic home into one of the, I think, best adaptive reuse case studies that we can share in Florida. I've also done some work that you'd consider almost archaeological in nature. We did the old Palm Beach County 1916 courthouse, which was wrapped in a 1970s building. Really dumb idea back in the 1960s. Instead of keeping the building alone and building a new courthouse, they decided to strip it down, build a large courthouse around it, four times in size. They were going to demolish it. In 2004, we did a study to save it, and it was saved, and now it's a history museum for all the visitors of Palm Beach County. So those are just two to name a couple of my projects.
Now you're vice chairman of the ACHP. What do you feel all of your background will bring to this position?
Well, I think I've been involved over the last dozen years in Florida with two groups of preservationists, one of them a nonprofit, the other one governmental side. On the nonprofit, I was a board member and past president of the Florida Trust for Historic Preservation. And there I was able to push for advocacy across the state. Not being part of government, that was very you know, straightforward. You could do that. You could go all over the state. And in fact, we formed a SWAT team, you know, so because the Florida Trust has board members all over the state, let's say in your town, Lynne, you know, you had a problem, they want to demolish a building. Well, we'd send two or three members and myself, I'd usually go to, and we go speak in behalf of saving the building, reusing a building. So the SWAT team continues. I just had my last board meeting last week, so I'm done with the Florida Trust, but I continue to help with advocacy. And the same thing on the Historical Commission, which is on the government side with the SHPO. On the commission, we help on the side of education and on the side of giving grants to save buildings. So I'm hoping I can take this state experience up to the national level in Washington and share the things that I've learned in 30 some years of practicing historic preservation. For example, recently, already my first conference call, there was discussions with the Army about what type of materials to use for siding, you know, and there's vinyl is a big no-no, right? And they were discussing that, right? So suggesting to them either wood or cementitious board, you know, other solutions that I've been able to apply successfully in Florida and share that with our national partners and the ACHP.
So our chairman, Aimee Jorjani, soon as you were appointed, she immediately approached you to join the Traditional Trades Task Force. And she's put you to work, I think, before your even final appointment. So tell me about your work with the Traditional Trades Task Force and how that's going.
Well, we have a great task force. It's we've had a couple of meetings already. And, you know, in the COVID age, we've been meeting on Zoom. So, but we still get to meet people, you know, over, we see their faces and their comments and their thoughts. I've been doing a lot of listening because I'm learning, you know, I just joined, but I hope to share, you know, my experience, my expertise. I hope to really think about young people, especially minorities, Latinos, African-American and others that may not have job opportunities. And I've always said in Florida, you know, I do a lot of new work too. And oh my God, to get a new work started, it takes 2 years. You got to go through planning and zoning. You got to draw a new, you know what I'm saying? It takes a long time, except historic buildings, the buildings are right there. You could start, someone could start cleaning the brick or restoring the windows while you're going through the permitting process. So you're talking about latent energy that we can get young people train and ready to join the workforce. Not everybody needs to go to college anymore. You know, most young people are thinking about their choices. I even shared that I think we should look at it even earlier in high school. My four children went through a magnet program here in Florida, and each one of them graduated from high school with a different specialty. One of my daughters can teach up to fifth grade. Another one was an artist. A third one engineering, and a fourth one finance. So how about we do a fifth one that's historic carpentry or preservation techniques, you know, so they can get up and running? Or how about we get the community colleges, right, to do a two-year degree or technical, you know, experience, you know, get the get people that are in the business creating these opportunities for all the young people that don't have work. And lastly, how about if we take all of this energy and we look at our wonderful work this country did the last time we had a depression in the 1930s, the WPA movement left us with so many beautiful buildings across the country. So many of them are neglected right now. Even bridges and dams, you know, I mean, that need work. So wouldn't it be interesting if in 2020 or 2021 and beyond that we could put a program together where we can get the young people through the traditional training to work on some of the jewels from the 1930s. I think it would be a win-win for all of us.
The president signed the Great American Outdoors Act today. And from what I hear, that is going to open the door to a lot of opportunity to utilize people with those type of skills, correct?
Agreed. And it's very good, but it's at the federal level, right? So how do we get that money to trickle down to the state level and the local level? You know the famous words, right? Preservation is at the local level, right? I mean, so I love it. It's a great first step. It's part of getting some cash to get going on our federal monuments. Every summer I go to the Smokies camping and, you know, you see some of the neglect. So it's great to hear that this is going to attack all of our historic, you know, national parks. I would hope we could find a way to get a trickle down to the state level and then to the county and local community levels, especially the rural communities in the country. You know, those communities that have a difficulty in raising funds to restore the unique downtowns and historic buildings that they have.
Thank you so much for talking to me and allowing our constituents to get to know you a little bit more, and hopefully as we go forward, maybe we'll actually get to meet in person.
I hope so.
Hopefully soon, very soon.
Hopefully soon, yes.
But anyway, thank you so much for joining me, and we look forward to working with you in the future.
Likewise, same thing here. Appreciate it, and hello to everyone, and let's get America back in preservation.